Diane, how are you a literal giant with such a small character? Before we hop into this video on the wasted potential of Diane's character, please do me a favor and drop your own thoughts on Diane's character in the comment section down below. Leave a like and subscribe if you haven't already. Also, hit the little notification bell so you don't miss out on any videos that come to the channel. Now, let's get into it. What's up, guys? Zach with the Pencil here, and here we are to talk about Diane's character and honestly the wasted potential I think it has. Now, let's be real. Diane's okay, and that's her biggest problem. So what do I mean? I think that Diane has, like, the most bland of all the Seven Deadly Sins characters, or at least specifically the Seven Deadly Sins. Out of her seven group, she's the least interesting character-wise. And yes, even worse than Merlin. And the thing is, Merlin doesn't really have a character. She just has mystery and intrigue behind her. And, like, very vague mystery and intrigue behind her. So when I have to say that Merlin's character is better than Diane's character, we've hit a problem. And you want to know why I think Diane honestly has the biggest issue in terms of character for all her fellow sins? I think it's because she's more of a plot device or a tool for the other sins' character arcs, specifically King and Gother. King and Gother use Diane for their character arcs so much that Diane sort of isn't allowed to have a character arc in between. She spends a good chunk of the series memory wiped, whether it be by King. And to be fair, that did happen pre-series, so it doesn't take up much of her modern series counterpart, but it's a big thing holding her character back, considering she's lost in love, supposedly with Meliodas, and not knowing about her past history with King, and the other half by Gother. And to be fair, Gother's thing is a memory wipe, but the thing is, it's like, it's such a random, not necessarily a random thing to do, because Diane is the person who brought up to Gother. The memories are, they aren't lost, they're just etched in our hearts. And Gother's like, memories are data, bro, watch this. And Gother literally made a pro gamer move and just erased their memories. But the thing is, she's locked behind that, and thus her real character arc is locked behind that. And the thing is, her real character arc isn't even that interesting. Her real, because that's the thing, she kind of figures out her character arc before the series begins. Like, she has it off screen. Her main point is that you don't always have to fight. It's okay to run, it's okay to rely on other people. Dying a warrior's death isn't something that's always necessary. And, like, she proved that forever ago to Matrona. The main reason Matrona's alive is because of Diane's own kind nature. So that character arc is basically non-existent, because it already happened in the span of, like, a 40-page side story. And then the other arc is, oh, I love King, not Meliodas. And, like, that was something that was established hundreds of years ago that's only now being brought to the forefront because you finally got all your memories back. And once Diane hits that point in around chapter, like, I think, like, 230 or something like that, Diane's character is over. Legitimately, it's just her waiting to get married to King. And then what else does she do? She gets possessed for a little bit, and then that's done, well and done with. That's more for Helbrum's character arc and King's development more than, but once again, that leads into Diane being a tool for other characters. Diane herself isn't allowed to be a character because Nakabo is like, wait a minute, I actually need Gother and King to develop, so let me just take your time away to dedicate to you. And that's the thing, I'm so disappointed because Diane is the second sin we meet in, like, the Seven Deadly Sins timeline. We go from Meliodas to Diane. So she's one of the first ones, aka she had the longest time period to actually get some juicy, meaty, proper development. But we just get nothing, really. Unless I'm missing something. That's the thing. I reread Seven Deadly Sins recently, as I do. And I was looking for it, mainly because I was planning to talk about all the different characters and what I think their wasted potential is, stuff I like about their characters and stuff like that. And the thing with Diane is, like, I just want more. Like, give her, like, a proper character arc. Not something that has to do with her ties into other characters, but no, that's the thing. You can have it tie into other characters because King and Gothers and Meliodas's and Escanor's and Bond all tie into other characters. But the thing about that is that all the characters they tie into, like, help develop them on their own. They go through their own personal and mental journeys. Diane doesn't really go on a mental journey. She goes on a, oh, I'm being cheated out of my proper feelings and memories by two people I love and trust. Okay. And, like, I suppose Diane's lesson that she's supposed to learn in her character arc, quote unquote, is that, oh, I need to learn to fight, and fighting is okay sometimes. But I feel like she even learned that to a degree. She fights. She doesn't really have a problem with fighting anymore. She just has a problem with, like, outright murder. And even then, she gets over that. So, like, the main thing that Diane's supposed to do, her whole character arc of learning when to fight, is sort of, like, contradicted by the idea that, no, you don't always have to fight. You can do it back and forth. And there isn't much there. like, whenever I'm looking back at Diane's character, I'm much more asking myself, what am I looking for, rather than, wow, this is so good. And it's just sad. Like, and I'm not even entirely sure what I would do to fix this wasted potential. Other than, like, maybe not make Diane a pacifist, but have her willingness to run, or her willingness to look back, or maybe turn her back on her problems, like, cause more issues for the narrative. Because, like, there's nothing there that teaches Diane that, okay, you need to fight explicitly. Like, that's the thing. All of Diane's character development happens in her backstory with Matrona. And then that's it. The rest is just love. And to be fair, it's love that she's known about for centuries, but wasn't allowed to know about because of King and Gother. So I'm sitting here like, where's the sauce? The thing is, I feel like the best way you could do that is, like, have one of her friends suffer, or have one of her friends die. Like, honestly, bring Dolores back into the narrative, but because of some people Diane let go or something like that, Dolores dies in front of her, or something like that. I mean, I guess Matrona technically died because of her actions, but that's the thing, it's all in her backstory. At least in my mind, Diane has no real present character development in modern Seven Deadly Sins. And that's the thing, that's not a problem. You can have flat characters, and you can have characters that have no real need to develop. I'd say Diane is like that. I'd say a lot of the Holy Knights end up being like that after a certain point. But it's just, in my mind, it's not as interesting, especially considering how complex the journeys of all these other characters are within Seven Deadly Sins. Within her very same group, you have so many other great characters that go through nice, interesting character journeys that don't rely on their memories being reset. That's what gets me about Diane. And that's just on, like, the character standpoint. Going into Diane herself, like, for a giant that can manipulate the earth into gigantic floating mountains and drop it down anywhere she pleases, man, she never does that. Like, she's so, not, it's weird to say fodder, but, like, after season one, what does Diane really do? Let's think about it. She has the friends golem. That's about it. She has the golems made of her friends, and they defeat the Drolan Gloxinia puppets. Not Drolan Gloxinia, the puppets. And then, after that, she fights Molascula alongside everyone else. And before that, she got possessed. And she did Mother Creation at the end of the series. And I guess she defended a little bit with the Demon King and, like, defended Merlin while she was casting the spell. Like, she doesn't do anything of note. Like, she doesn't have a King versus Mael moment, like this big awakening where she slaps a major villain. She doesn't have a Merlin versus Grey Road moment, a big revelation revealed about the character, then becoming way stronger. She doesn't have a Meliodas versus the Demon King moment where he flexes so hard that he blasts the Demon King's arm off. She doesn't have a Bond versus the Demon King moment where she comes back after getting way stronger and slaps up a major threat. She doesn't have even a real Escanor moment. Well, to be fair, Escanor has a whole bunch of moments, but still, she doesn't have a moment where Escanor versus Gallen, Escanor versus the Demon King, Escanor versus everybody, pretty much, except for, like, Zeldris, because Zeldris is a menace. But yeah, every other sin in her group really has, like, a standout, big brain, lay it down on the tape. Well, actually not Gother. Gother really doesn't have any of those moments, but we're going to talk about Gother at another time. But essentially, but you know, Gother does have a character arc and some interesting abilities. And the thing is, I'm sitting here looking at Diane like, what'd you do? And the main thing is, I guess you could say her big moment is her scaring off Helbrum. But, like, and I guess she did beat Helbrum, because Helbrum had to run. Helbrum was told by Henriksen to get up out of there because Diane awoke to her true potential. But that's really it. Like, Diane doesn't have, like, a moment where I'm like, yeah, that's a Diane moment. Yeah, that's hype. That's exciting. That's real. Outside of that one thing. And I don't know. It feels like Diane's just not enough. And it feels like Diane's, like, sort of this incomplete character. I think half of that has to do with the fact that she's not necessarily allowed to be, like, full-on, real menace, top-tier Earth Manipulator like she should be. Like, not gonna lie, she should be throwing, like, islands at people, continents, countries. I know I just went down. But still, she should be doing more, like, massive things, especially as the series progresses. Because unlike pretty much every other character outside of Gother, Like, there's no real solid power progression when it comes to Diane. Like, Meliodas has his transformations. Like, you can see him go from Demon Mark to Assault Mode to his true magic state. That's growth. You have King Spirit Spear. It levels up alongside him. Merlin's spells get bigger. Bond kind of just gets stronger, because mainly because he plateaus for so long that when he finally comes back, you can just tell the noticeable difference in strength. You take a look at someone like Big Papa Escanor. You can also tell his noticeable changes in strength because of how much bigger he gets. Like, these characters all have these, like, different transitionary growth periods in terms of character and power. Except for Gothar, once again, because Gothar kind of just zooms and gets back. We're going to talk about Gothar later. But the thing is, Diane doesn't necessarily have one of those. Even, like, I'm not even going to lie, Mother Creation was more underwhelming to me than Mother Catastrophe. Mother Catastrophe felt like a big moment. It felt like Diane really manipulating the Earth to its peak and to its limit. Like, Mother Creation looked cool, but it just made a giant plateau, made a giant platform that was, like, just enough bigger than a lake. It didn't hit that hard for me. Meanwhile, Mother Catastrophe did, and I think that's another thing that does Diane dirty. Because of the small scale that Nakabo wants to try to keep the world to, he doesn't allow for, like, big bombastic moments of someone, like, throwing a country at one another. Like, Diane's power growth, especially by the end of the series, considering how strong she got compared to her beginning of series self on top of Gideon, should have literally just been able to be like, okay guys, everyone duck, and then everyone's like, wait, Diane, what do you mean? Oh my lord. And then just a gigantic slab of landmass comes flying at somebody. She should have had a moment like that where she, like, we see her cumulative power growth. Like, we see a whole leap, a whole pull of just growth. Like, that's the thing. Diane doesn't really grow. And I think that's the main issue for me. She stays stagnant. Like, character-wise, power-wise, even though I know she's stronger, she's way stronger. The end of series Diane would slap beginning of series Diane. No question. But that's, like, the scale of me. There's no visual indication. There's nothing there that truly is like, yes, this shows the accumulation of Diane's entire journey. This is everything I've seen up to this point. It's because Diane doesn't really have a journey. She's sort of just chilling there, being a tool for other people's character journeys. And that's not fun. That's nowhere near as fun or interesting as any of the other character journeys in the Seven Deadly Sins. And, like, the sad thing about this Wasted Potential is that this encapsulates an entire character. When I did the Wasted Potential of Meliodas, Leader of the Ten Commandments, the thing was, that was a part of Meliodas' past. I still think Meliodas, the main character in terms of modern Seven Deadly Sins, is very interesting. He goes through a very interesting journey and stuff like that. He has a very interesting character. Diane, though, her entire character is kind of just flat. It's kind of boring to me. And I think that's a pretty big issue for one of seven characters that's supposed to be our main cast, one of the seven characters that the show is named for. And the sad thing is, I have no real idea, like, what to do other than I would literally have to break some of Nakaba's rules. For, like, the character progression standpoint, I would legitimately have Diane, like, drop a meteorite on somebody. Like, literally just call from the heavens a gigantic meteorite down on the Demon King or something like that. That's what I would do for the power standpoint, to show that literal progression. Like, you have Mother Catastrophe, and let Mother Creation be like Mother Devastation or something like that, where she literally just calls down maybe like a chunk of the moon or something like that. Something big, something hefty, something epic to display how much Diane has grown. And for her character, the simplest fix I would have is, like, not make Diane a pacifist, because I think that's a little bit too much. If I'm sticking to what Diane needs to learn by the end of the series, that love is okay, and that, not love is okay, but people love her, and the right people love her, not who she thinks, and on top of the idea that it's okay to fight for all you have, as long as you're fighting for good reasons, then I think the best thing I would do is have Diane, in fact, this could even work for Diane as, like, a character who's, like, forced to be suppressed within the narrative with her true potential. Legitimately just have it so Diane almost never does, like, big earth manipulation things. Like, she's never comfortable doing it because she's looking around at all these smaller people that she cares about and she doesn't want to hurt them. Because while throwing around a mountain may be nothing to her, it could definitely be something to someone as small as Elizabeth or someone as small as Hawk or someone as small as King. Like, if they get hit by that, they could die in her mind. Then you just have this slow buildup of Diane, like, slowly learning more and more about herself and how her friends view her relative to herself and stuff like that. And bit by bit, you see Diane get more and more comfortable. And, like, she still has those moments where, like, her inability or her not want to fight or go all out still works out for her, like the case with Zeldris in the past. Like, that entire little mini arc she has with Droll, which is really mainly for Droll's character development once again, because Diana's just a tool for other people's characters. That moment, that can still happen, but let her realize the slow balance of, there are times where I need to go all out. I can have the faith in my friends that they will survive this because they have trust in me like I have trust in them. Let that be her arc. Let her be learning to trust people, and her, I guess, yeah, like, have her learn to trust people relative to herself and realize that she, while she may be gigantic, is not truly an outcast to any of her friends. Then I feel like that would make her a bit more tied into the story, and even then, it's not enough. Like, in my mind, I feel like there should be a bit more, but I'm trying to keep to the limits of Diane's character without changing everything fundamentally. Because I feel like if you really want to make Diana a fully interesting character, you may have to go to the drawing board again. Like, if you want to give her a true proper character arc and stuff like that, you may have to go to the drawing board. But I don't think we should try to go to the drawing board, because she's such a necessary element of the narrative. And honestly, I don't have any idea. Like, if you remove Diane from the narrative, that's the main issue. I'm going to wrap up because I know I'm going to be going for a bit too long. If you remove Diane from the narrative as she is right now and try to fix her for she herself as a character, it kind of messes up other people's character arcs. So she's a very pivotal part of other character arcs, from Droll to King to Gothir. She's very important in other people's stories, but she doesn't have much importance for her herself or her own story. So you would kind of have to, like, insert this around other stuff, which is going to be difficult. And honestly, I may do an entire video about that. I may do like a fixing Diane's character while trying to keep her main purpose as a tool for other characters in the narrative. That may be something I'll do. I'm not sure. This is something I'm thinking of off the top of my head. I don't even have this plan. So that may be something I'll do. Tell me if you'd be interested in seeing that. But speaking of telling me things, please tell me what you guys think about Diane's character. You think I'm nuts? Do you think, like, her power growth should have stayed as small as it was throughout the entire series? Like, throwing meteorites may be a bit too much. And do you think that her character is fine as it is? Would you change anything about it? And how would you change it? How would you change her power growth if you want to? How would you change her character growth if you want to? If you think everything's fine, tell me that too. I'd love to hear it. Honestly, I think Diane's fine too. I just wish there was a little bit more. That's what I want. Always like a little bit extra juicy, a little extra meat with my characters. I feel like Diane's a little bit too flat and boring as a character, especially in her series, which is full of great characters. But that's what I think. Please tell me what you guys think in the comment section down below. Thank you guys so much for watching. Please remember to like, share, comment, and subscribe. And I hope you guys have a wonderful day. This is That Guy with the Pencil, writing off.